Welcome to the weekly webcast. Each week, these messages are brought to you with practical help for daily living. It is our hope that you will be encouraged and challenged by this message and that you'll share it with a friend. A bird hatches in the nest, grows, develops feathers, and prepares for the day when it will finally leave its home. The bird is programmed by God to fly, meaning it knows what must be done, but that doesn't mean it is able to perform it perfectly the first time. And if there are predators below, failure can be deadly. Moving from theory to reality can be challenging, and this is what Moses, Joshua, Samuel, and Paul found out. Moses went from being a prince of Egypt to a lowly shepherd, and that's when God activated him and he was able to put into practice the many things he had learned in his first 80 years on earth. Joshua was an understudy of Moses, but eventually he had to stand on his own and know whether God was truly with him. The prophet Samuel was younger than most when he moved from theory to reality. The apostle Paul had a life-changing experience when everything he knew to be true was turned upside down, and a hated Christian showed up to deliver healing and confirm the same message he had already heard from God. This message is entitled, Theory to Reality. Welcome to Resurrection Life of Jesus Church today, and today's message is going to be titled Theory to Reality. In the messages that I've done going back, we've just been kind of progressing along, and today we're going to be talking about what we know and what we actually experience. Before I want to begin and open up in prayer. Father God, as we read through your Bible here today, and as we go through this, we just ask that help us to read and to understand the words that you have for us here today. Let us not read without understanding, but let us read with discernment. And in doing so, we can be progressing along here in this Christian life. And we thank you for this now in Jesus' name. Amen. When you look at a bird, everybody knows that a bird flies. And so the bird starts with simple origins inside of an egg. And this egg is placed inside of a nest by its parents. And eventually the time comes when the bird grows large enough inside the egg that the time comes, it's time to break out. And so it pushes and prods and it breaks out and it struggles to become free. And then it begins receiving nourishment from its parents, and it grows, and initially it doesn't have any feathers. It just has like this nice soft down, and then these feathers, or this down slowly turns into feathers, and in all this time, the bird never leaves the nest. But see, God has programmed this bird to fly. It knows innately how to fly, but it hasn't done it. And so it begins testing its wings out, but it doesn't leave the nest. And so today I want to talk about theory to reality. You see, theory is that the bird can fly. Reality is that time that bird takes that first leap out of that nest, opens its wings, and soars. Now, does every bird fly perfectly the first time? No. Sometimes they do crash into the ground. I myself rescued one of these little birds when I was young and kind of nourished it a little bit, and it got strong, and then it took off. And kind of the sad thing was, is a neighborhood cat saw it. It landed on the ground and the cat just pounced on it. I thought, all this effort that I put into saving this little bird for naught. I was very angry with this cat. The cat was simply doing what it had been programmed to do. Now, the point being is that when the bird leaves the nest, it doesn't always have success. It should have success, but if there are predators down below, it can be fatal or deadly for the bird to leave the nest and to fail. And so as Christians, you know, we will always want to have success. You can go to any bookstore and read about books on success. You know, the Christian walk, the victory, how to have victory, success in life. Any schmuck can write that, all right? Now, those people that do write all those success books, do they talk about their failures too? You see, they paint this shining picture of life is wonderful. And you can go and look at some television preachers. I'm not going to name any names right now. But all they talk about is positivity and how life is good. And, oh, I wrote a book on success. And look at me in my $2,000 suit. And my life is all together. And they project an image that their life is perfect, that they don't have any problems whatsoever. But that's completely false. Because if we're going to be real, everybody is struggling with issues. Now, a child's issues are going to be vastly different than an adult who has issues, right? You might both be experiencing health issues, but one might be more serious. Now, I just remember my brother when we were younger, and my brother was 10 years younger than me, so he was quite a bit younger, and we had this pool, and you know, it had a plastic bottom, and it had hard plastic sides. I guess it was a rubber bottom. And somehow or another, something had happened, and there was like a little hole that had been poked in there. Like, we're talking like the size of a needle. And there was just a little bit of water coming out. And my brother, he saw this, and he said, I know what to do. And he went, and he got himself a Band-Aid. And he put it on there, and he opened it up, and he stretched it out, and it stopped the dripping for a little bit, and then it flooded through the Band-Aid, because a Band-Aid is not meant to be watertight. But that was a big problem for him at the time, and then I looked at it differently. I was obviously older, and I said, well, what we're going to need to do is maybe drain it so that we can dry it, we can put something that's watertight, put some glue, put some tape, we can do something. But it was a disaster for him because he's just like, this is my pool. It's leaking, right? Now, it doesn't matter what age that we're at. When we have disasters that happen, they're real to us. It is real to a child, and it is real to an adult. And so the Christian life, we talk about sometimes all this theory, and that's what it is. It's theory. And then we have to put it into practice. And that's when it becomes challenging. Jesus said, love everyone, but you don't feel like loving everyone, especially the people who are hurting you, the people who are despitefully using you. Jesus said, pray for your enemies, but I don't want to, God. He said, turn the other cheek. Yeah, I know what you said, but I really don't want to. So there's a lot of theory that we have, and then many times we struggle to put that theory into practice. This is that process that basically challenges your soul, your heart, your soul, whatever term you want to use. But we have to basically be introspective, and we have to figure out why we believe what we believe and why we believe it. Now, my children know that I love them. I have done my best to share the truth of the Bible with them. They know about God. They know about the creation account. They know what took place in the Garden of Eden. And they know that we need a Savior. They know some basics, okay? They know that Jesus came to this earth, that he lived, that he died on the cross, that he rose again on the third day. They know that in the book of Acts that the baptism of the Holy Spirit was powerful, that it came in like a mighty rushing wind, a lot of people were saved. They know the basics of this. And a lot of it is just theory. Like birds, they're in the nest right now, they're just kind of trying it out. The Bible also likens them to arrows that get launched, but they're not ready to be launched yet. You see, the Bible says that arrows, children are like arrows, and one day I will launch them out into the world when they're ready. And then they're going to encounter the same problems that everybody else encounters. But instead of hitting a professor in college that fills them with doubt and unbelief about the veracity of the Bible, they'll stand strong and they'll simply say, Professor, you are wrong. And they begin to now move from theory into reality. and more and more and more so. I would invite you to turn to Exodus chapter 3. We're going to look at Moses here this morning. Moses had a very interesting life, and many times we think about, well, we can live a certain amount of time here on the earth. I myself have, in the past, divided my life into two terms, the first 60 years and the latter 60 years. I'd like to look at it a little bit differently today. Let's divide it not semesters, but trimesters. You see, Moses, in the first 40 years of his life, he was a prince of Egypt. As a prince of Egypt, he had every advantage that was given to him. He was being trained to be a future ruler over a country. And a future ruler must know how to rule effectively, or everything that the previous king had built up will be squandered and gone to waste. And so he spent his first 40 years being this prince. He didn't necessarily know his background, and he began to discover this toward the end of his 40 years, and he saw injustice taking place with the Israelites as slaves in Egypt, and it really irked him of what was going on. And he took matters into his own hands, and he killed someone. This necessitated that he fled. And he went from being this elevated prince of Egypt to a lowly shepherd. You go out, it's dusty. You live in a tent. You spend time with stupid sheep all day long. They could be great company, but they're not intelligent. And you have to be able to provide them with water and a source of food to eat. And Moses must have gone into a depression as he went from the first 40 years of his life to the second 40 years of his life. And where we're going to pick him up here in chapter 3 is that he more or less had resigned himself. I am a shepherd. This is what I do. This is my destiny. This is it. This is all that there is to life. And yet he didn't know that God had other plans. That the next 40 years, the third trimester of his life, was going to be vastly different than anything he had experienced before. There was a training period of where he was in theory to theory. The first 80 years of his life was preparing him for the final 40 years. And even though he had had 80 years of experience to prepare himself, Moses still messed up. He was a human being. He wasn't perfect. He didn't do everything. He never even got into the promised land because he sinned, because he let anger take over. That doesn't take away from all the good things that he did. In Exodus chapter 3 and verse 1, we read this. Now Moses kept the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian, and he led the flock to the backside of the desert and came to the mountain of God, even to Horeb. And the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire out of the midst of the bush. And he looked, and behold, the bush burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed. And Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight, why this bush is not burnt. That would be, you know, something that would kind of catch your attention, right? Fire consumes things, and yet this fire is not consuming something. Verse 4, and when the Lord saw that he turned aside to see, God called unto him out of the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. And he said, Here am I. And he said, Draw not hither. Put off your shoes from off your feet, for the place where you stand is holy ground. Moreover, he said, I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon God. And the Lord said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people which are in Egypt, and have heard their cry by reason of their taskmasters, for I know their sorrows. And I am come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians, and to bring them up out of that land and unto a good land, and a large, and unto a land flowing with milk and honey, unto the place of the Canaanites, and the Hittites, and the Amorites, and the Perizzites, and the Hivites, and the Jebusites. Now, therefore, behold, the cry of the children of Israel is come unto me. I have also seen the oppression wherewith the Egyptians oppress them. Come now, therefore, and I will send you unto Pharaoh, that you may bring forth my people, the children of Israel, out of Egypt. We read this a little bit last week. You see, God is operating on eternity time, not men's time, his time, eternity time. And in operating in eternity time, God said, I'm going to set aside a certain amount of time for them to be down in Egypt. It was over 400 years. And you say, wow, that's a really long time. Well, if 1 hour with God is a little over 41 and a half years, and 1 minute with God is 8 months and 8 days, and 1 second with God is 3 days and 22 hours, were they really in Egypt that long? Not really. It's just our way of looking at it. And now God said, now is the time. Now is the time where I'm going to move. So Moses, he had been learning under his father-in-law. Jethro was a high priest. He served God. If you look at it and you would say, wow, Moses sure was lucky that when he fled Egypt, he happened to come upon Jethro. Well, it wasn't luck. It was ordained. It was God doing things and setting things up and moving his pieces around. Jethro was going to play an important part in Moses' life. Jethro would be here. Moses would leave, go to Egypt, take the Israelites out. Jethro would reconnect with him. Jethro would say, hey, you're working way too hard. You need to set up other judges and so forth. Jethro would come in and out of his life. And God was bringing him in and moving things around how he wanted according to his timing. Now, even though Moses had this awesome experience with God, and God tells him what his name is, and Moses says, well, who shall I tell the people that sent? You know, what is your name? And God said, I am that I am. In other words, he's the existing one. That didn't mean that Moses is like, okay, I got it. We're going to Egypt. Everything's going to be good. Did Moses struggle from that point on? Yeah, that's the good thing about the Bible is that it brings out all, it gives us a true account. Not only does it share all the good things, all the victories and stuff, but it shares personal struggles at times as well. And as it says in 1 Corinthians, it says, now these things are written to us for an example. Why are they an example? So that we can learn from them. Now Joshua was an understudy of Moses. Joshua and Moses, they connected at some point when Moses came to Egypt. Joshua was a good man. He was somebody that God also saw value in. And so as Moses is moving along, Joshua naturally just stepped up and said, I'm behind you, Moses. And he was backing him up, and he was there. If Moses needed some kind of help, Joshua was there. How do you think Joshua felt, though, when Moses' time came to an end on this earth? God had made it very clear in the midst of Korah's rebellion and other times, even when Miriam And Aaron had questioned Moses' leadership. And God had basically struck Miriam with leprosy and dealt very harshly with her and Aaron, had killed Korah and his followers, and God had made it crystal clear that Moses was his man. He was the chosen person that he wanted to work through with the Israelites. How then do you think Joshua felt when the time came for him to assume the mantle of leadership? Moses has passed on. Nobody knows where he's buried. They've mourned for him now. And now the Israelites are like, okay, now what? Well, everybody knew that Joshua was the second in command. But what do you think was going through Joshua's mind, the man Joshua himself? Well, let's turn over to Joshua chapter 1. And we begin to see a little bit of his mindset. Because in the first chapter, God repeats himself a few times. And when he repeats himself, it means that he wants to reinforce a point. This is for us when we're reading this. We pick this up here in verse 1. Now after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord, it came to pass that the Lord spake unto Joshua, the son of Nun, Moses' minister, saying, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now, therefore, arise, go over this Jordan, you and all this people, unto the land which I do give to them, even to the children of Israel. Every place that the sole of your foot shall tread upon, that have I given unto you, as I said unto Moses. From the wilderness and this side Lebanon, even unto the great river, the river Euphrates, all the land of the Hittites, and unto the great sea toward the going down of the sun shall be your coast. There shall not any man be able to stand before you all the days of your life. As I was with Moses, so I will be with you. I will not fail you, nor forsake you. Be strong and of a good courage. For unto this people shall you divide for an inheritance the land which I swear unto their fathers to give them. Only be thou strong and very courageous, that you may observe to do according to all the law which Moses my servant commanded you. Turn not from it to the right hand or to the left, that you may prosper whithersoever you go. This book of the law shall not depart out of your mouth, but you shall meditate therein day and night, that you may observe to do according to all that is written therein. For then you shall make your way prosperous, and then you shall have good success. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and of a good courage. Be not afraid, neither be thou dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. The key in all of this was that God said, I want you to listen to my commandments and follow through with obedience. But in doing so, Joshua, I'm not going to abandon you. I'm not going to forsake you. I'm going to be with you. And wherever you choose to go, the sky's the limit. Joshua reached for the sky many times. Now, did Joshua fail? Yeah. He failed one time spectacularly with the men of Gibeon. The men of Gibeon came and disguised themselves, and they said, you know what? We're going to put on old, ratty clothing. We're going to put moldy bread. We're going to make it look like we've traveled from a far distance. And Joshua failed to say, hey, God, do you want me to make an alliance with them? That's all he needed to have asked. God would have said no. He didn't ask, so he made an alliance. And then God said, what have you done? You didn't consult me. Put that mistake off. They're fighting a battle in another time. The day is now running out. It's going good for them, but they need more time. And Joshua remembers God's promise, and so he basically says with boldness, I command the sun and the moon to stand still in the sky. Now, anybody can say those words, but getting that to actually take place, well, that's a different matter. You need a miracle. You need supernatural intervention in order to make that happen. This is kind of what we're talking about, moving from theory into reality. What do you think it did for Joshua's faith when he was able to say that and it actually happened? Wow. Wow. No one could take that away from him. For the rest of his life, he would be able to say, children, grandchildren, little cousins, nieces and nephews, gather around. I want to tell you a story. And no one could tell him otherwise and say, oh, that was just your imagination. No, I lived through this. I was an eyewitness. I did this. There were other people that saw this as well. And this is the beautiful thing about our testimonies. Our testimonies are our personal experiences. They cannot be taken away from us. People can poo-poo them, they can naysay them, but if you have received a touch from God, if you've received a miracle, if you received an answer to prayer, if he's given you divine knowledge about something, if you're operating in the baptism of the Holy Spirit, the nine gifts, no one can take that away from you. They can say whatever they want, but it doesn't matter. Your personal testimony is what you know to be true. That's the difference between theory and reality. Theory is, well, I know that my dad has experienced this. I know that somebody else has done this. I know this. Reality is when you're doing it yourself, right? That's the thing that no one can take away from you. Joshua, here in chapter 1, he had to figure out on his own whether God was truly with him. And God was not lacking in miracles. At the onset, they're on the far side. They're on the other side of the Jordan River. And God says, we're going to cross over. And he pulls a miniature Red Sea out of it, splits the Jordan River. They walk across on dry land. There isn't anybody that could naysay that. This is why Joshua was saying toward the end of his life, as he was now passing the mantle of leadership on, and he said, choose you this day. Make that choice, right? Because that's what it comes down to. For every single one of us, my children cannot ride my coattails into heaven. You must be a son or daughter of God. There are no grandchildren in heaven. They must come to Jesus on their own and in faith make that decision. That's what it is. There are no grandchildren. There are no great-grandchildren in heaven, only sons and daughters of God. And the only way that you can do that is by having that one-on-one experience with God. Joshua had that. He moved from theory into reality, and this is why he was able to say what he said at the end of his life. Let's flip over to 1 Samuel chapter 3. Samuel had quite the experience also. Samuel was a miracle because his mother wanted children, and yet she could not have children. She desperately wanted children to the point where she was at the tabernacle at Shiloh and she's praying and Eli thinks she's drunk. She's just kind of like mumbling and she's in so much distress and he was angry with her. And she said, I'm not drunk. I'm asking God to give me an answer to my prayer. Eli didn't have the power in him to do it, but he just said, As a high priest, he said, God will grant you your prayer. Shortly thereafter, Samuel was born. She had promised God, God, if you give me a son, I will give him to you. He spent a number of years, because you can't just give a baby to God. She raised him up, and he was a young man when she brought him to Eli. And then she left him there, because she made a promise. And the one thing that God wants is when we make a promise, keep the promise. If you don't intend on making a promise, say, well, don't say anything. My mother taught me this early on in life. She said, I won't promise you, but I will try. I will try, but I won't promise you because I'm not certain that I can keep that. Sometimes we have we're well-meaning when we say things, and then we say things and we can't keep them. It's a lie then. She said something, God, if you give me a child, I will give him to you. She moved from theory into reality, and she had to give Samuel to God, or she would be a liar. Now, that doesn't mean she never saw him again. But now we pick up here in chapter 3, and it says, and the child Samuel ministered unto the Lord before Eli, and the word of the Lord was precious in those days, and there was no open vision. Meaning, God wasn't necessarily speaking to prophets, or maybe there were prophets or not, but God wasn't speaking. That's why the word of the Lord was precious. And it came to pass at that time that Eli was laid down in his place, and his eyes began to wax dim, that he could not see. And ere the lamp of God went out in the temple of the Lord where the ark was, and Samuel was laid down to sleep. And then the Lord called Samuel, and he said, answered, here am I. And he ran to Eli and said, here am I, for you called me. And he said, I called not. Lie down again. And he went and lay down. And the Lord called yet again, Samuel. And Samuel arose and went to Eli and said, here am I, for you did call me. And he answered, I called not, my son. Lie down again. Now Samuel did not know the Lord, neither was the word of the Lord yet revealed unto him. And the Lord called Samuel again the third time, and he arose and went to Eli, and he said, here am I, for you did call me. And Eli perceived that the Lord had called the child. Three times now Samuel has interrupted his sleep. The third time Eli says, oh, I realize what's happening here. God is talking to Samuel. This is special. Therefore, Eli said unto Samuel, go lie down, and it shall be, if he call you, that you shall say, speak, Lord, for your servant hears. So Samuel went and lay down in his place. And the Lord came and stood and called as at other times, Samuel, Samuel. Then Samuel answered, speak, for your servant hears. And the Lord said to Samuel, behold, I will do a thing in Israel, at which both the ears of everyone that hears it shall tingle. In that day I will perform against Eli all the things which I have spoken concerning his house. When I begin, I will also make an end. For I have told him that I will judge his house forever for the iniquity which he knows, because his sons made themselves vile, and he restrained them not. And therefore have I sworn against the house of Eli, that the iniquity of Eli's house shall not be purged with sacrifice nor offering forever. And Samuel lay until morning and opened the doors of the house of the Lord. And Samuel feared to show Eli the vision. Then Eli called Samuel and said, Samuel, my son. And he answered, here am I. And he said, what is the thing that the Lord has said unto you? I pray you hide it not from me. God do so to you and more also if you hide anything from me of all the things that he said unto you. In other words, give it to me straight. Don't sugarcoat it. I know God told you something. I know it's concerning me. Tell everything to me. And Samuel told him every whit and hid nothing from him. And he said, it is the Lord. Let him do what seems good. And Samuel grew, and the Lord was with him, and did none of his words fall to the ground. And all Israel, from Dan even to Beersheba, knew that Samuel was established to be a prophet of the Lord. A prophet to the Lord. Samuel was raised in the knowledge of God when it came to his mother. His mother was a God-fearing woman. It's not like he suddenly found out about God on the day that she brought him to Eli and said, here you go. He already had a knowledge of God. She had imparted that to him. But what it tells us is that he didn't have necessarily a relationship with God. And this was God reaching out and having that one-on-one conversation. And it's special. In the process of having that one-on-one conversation, God told him certain things that weren't necessarily pleasant. But the point being is that Samuel moved from theory about knowing about God to knowing God. No one from that day forth could say, well, you don't know God. And he'd say, actually, he talks to me. Really? Yeah. We have conversations. I talk, he talks, it's verbal, it's not in my head. No one could take that away from Samuel. In addition, Samuel was now being given supernatural knowledge about things, people, and events to come. No one could naysay this. That's the beauty of this, is our testimony is that when we move from theory to reality, people can say what they want, but we know what has happened and it doesn't change those facts. Last example I want to look at here is Paul. Let's flip over to Acts chapter 9. Now, Paul was a man who sought after God. As a Pharisee, he, in his own words, he described himself as perfect and blameless. In other words, he tried to follow the laws that he knew to the best of his ability, meaning, you know, everything that the Pharisees required themselves to do, you know, he was the best of the best. There was no one who could say, well, you know, I'm better than Paul. If, you know, someone prayed for 2 hours, Paul prayed for 4 hours. If he, you know, memorized scripture, Paul had, you know, this memorized and more. Paul basically said, you know, there's no one that surpasses me. And he had a zeal for God. Now, he happened to be on the wrong team. And God was going to poach a player from the devil's team and move this player over to his team. And that same zeal that Saul, who would become Paul, was using to persecute and basically bring so much destruction to the church of Jesus, he was now going to turn this zeal into this all-consuming fire of just spreading the gospel. And you've only to read the New Testament, but I'm getting ahead of myself here. In Acts chapter 9, verse 1, we said, "And Saul, yet breathing out threatenings and slaughter against the disciples of the Lord, went unto the high priest and desired of him letters to Damascus to the synagogues, that if he found any of this way, that would be Christians, whether they were men or women, he might bring them bound unto Jerusalem. And as he journeyed, he came near Damascus, and suddenly there shined round about him a light from heaven. And he fell to the earth and heard a voice saying unto him, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? Or why are you persecuting me?" Now, I don't know about you, but I suppose in today's level of technology, you could have a drone with a speaker hovering over you. But back then, there was no such level of technology. And if a light is shining out of heaven during the day, and you hear a booming voice, and they're speaking to you directly, it's kind of an attention grabber. But Saul is not sure who it is. And so he plays it safe, and he says, "Who are you?" And the Lord said, "I am Jesus whom you persecute." Wow, that must have been a knife to his heart right off the bat. Now, there are things that are going to happen to Saul now in very quick succession that if that was all, if he had just sat there on his horse and just kind of pondered that, but he wasn't going to be given that situation at that moment. Jesus continues, "It is hard for you to kick against the pricks." And Paul, trembling and astonished, said, "Lord, what will you have me to do?" And the Lord said to him, "Arise and go into the city, and it shall be told you what you must do." Now, the men which journeyed with him stood speechless, hearing a voice, but seeing no man. And Saul arose from the earth, and when his eyes were opened, he saw no man. And they led him by the hand and brought him unto Damascus. And he was there 3 days without sight, and neither did eat nor drink. Everything that Saul knew to be true, in one instant had been turned upside down. He thought he was doing the will of God by persecuting this heretical cult called the Christians. Jesus, who had claimed to be the Son of God, who had, you know, died, and somebody had stolen his body so that he could, you know, claim to be risen 3 days later. This is what Saul believed. And he thought he was serving God by persecuting and just causing destruction to the church. And when we say persecuting, we're not just talking like, you know, throwing some fists around. We're talking killing people. He had men and women killed. There were children who had no mother, no father because of this man. The Bible says that he laid waste to the church. Those are very strong words. 3 days he could not see. So miserable that he's not eating or drinking. His whole world has been turned upside down. Verse 10 now. And there was a certain disciple at Damascus named Ananias. And to him said the Lord in a vision, Ananias. And he said, Behold, I am here, Lord. And the Lord said unto him, Arise, and go into the street which is called Straight, and inquire in the house of Judas for one called Saul of Tarsus. Behold, he prays. And he has seen in a vision a man named Ananias coming in and putting his hand on him that he might receive his sight. Then Ananias answered, Lord, I have heard by many of this man how much evil he has done to the saints at Jerusalem. And here he has authority from the chief priest to bind all that call upon your name. But the Lord said unto him, Go your way, for he is a chosen vessel unto me to bear my name before the Gentiles and kings and the children of Israel. For I will show him how many great things he must suffer for my name's sake. And Ananias went his way and entered into the house, and putting his hands on him said, Brother Saul, the Lord, even Jesus that appeared unto you in the way as you came, has sent me that you might receive your sight and be filled with the Holy Ghost. And there immediately there fell from his eyes as had been scales, and he received sight forthwith and arose and was baptized. Now, God spoke to Saul. God spoke to Ananias. Ananias is a Christian. This is who Saul is coming to arrest, Christians. He gives them the same message, takes two people then, brings Ananias over. Do you begin to see the intricacy of God's timing here in all this? Chess pieces moving around. God is in control of this situation. And he brings Ananias, and Ananias says to him, Brother Saul, in verse 17, the Lord, even Jesus. What must this have done to the other men that were there? Because there were other men that came with Saul. Jesus has sent me to you. Jesus is supposed to be dead. What are we talking about here? His body was stolen. He's dead. Nope, they're talking about Jesus in the present tense, like he's alive. And yet, Jesus had verbally spoken to Saul. He had verbally spoken to Ananias. Ananias is moving in not just theory, he's moving in reality. This is a man who is a Christian, who is walking with God. This is not new to him. What? I think someone's talking to me. Is that what Ananias said? Did Ananias say, I feel that the Lord is impressing upon me that I should go to a street called Straight and talk to a man named Saul? Is that what he said? No, but that's what a lot of people in Christian churches today say. I feel that the Lord, well, either God said something or he did not. Feelings, you know, feelings betray us. When God speaks, when Jesus speaks here to Ananias, Ananias doesn't question him. Ananias is moving in reality. But he's also concerned for his health because he says, you know why he's here. He's here to arrest people like me. to beat me up, even kill me. God says, I'm in control. This is happening. Everything that's happening right now is happening according to my timing. And he confirms it in verse 15 when he says that Saul is a chosen vessel. I have plans for him. So, theory to reality. Let's talk about the U.S. Army. Now, anybody who joins an army, it doesn't matter. You could join the British Army, Pakistani Army. Every army is going to have a basic training. You can't not take people that are simply civilians and just put them into the army and then say, okay, you're a soldier now. You have to train them. So part of training is that there's the physical challenges. As soon as you get in, they start yelling and screaming at you. You are running. You are doing sit-ups. You are doing push-ups. You are just physically exerting yourself. If you mess up in the slightest infraction, physical punishment is going to be happening to you. You're going to be running all the more. And so they begin to train the body, right? This is the purpose of this, is training the body. But what they're also doing is in the process of doing this, is they're changing the way that these new recruits are thinking. You see, we have a way that all of us has a way of doing certain things. But you bring in 500 new recruits and you have 500 different ways of doing something, that's going to cause chaos. What we need to do is we need to unify all these people to begin thinking the same way. And when we can all get them on the same page together, thinking the same way and be physically fit, we can now do something with these men. They can now become soldiers. So, they once they graduate from basic training, these soldiers now, they have a theoretical knowledge of warfare. They haven't been blooded yet. In other words, they've had people firing guns over them. If they're crawling on the ground and they're getting in the mud and they're going up and down over things and there's explosions going off, but everything is controlled to a certain extent so as not to cause harm to these recruits, because you need them. You don't want to lose half of them because you're using live bullets firing into them or throwing grenades into their midst and killing off them. This doesn't help. You're not going to get anybody to want to join the army. Right now, it's voluntarily, but you'd have to conscript them then. All right, so they have a theoretical knowledge. Now, once you send them into combat and they go to another place, they now meet up with an enemy. This enemy is prepared. This enemy is going to actively resist them. And now comes the time when it becomes necessary to put everything you've been practicing, right, the theory, into reality, put it into practice. This enemy is not going to say, oh, you want to have a do-over? Okay, all right, time out. Everybody return to their previous positions. We'll do this again. In warfare, it's bloody, it's messy, and many times, if you make a mistake, one mistake, it could cost your life. It may cost you just your limb or your sight or something, but now you're out, okay? I think you can kind of see where I'm going with this, is that the Christian life is we have an active enemy too, right? Now, I spoke to you earlier about my children. Now, let's talk about discipleship. Young children, right? We teach them about God, the basics. We teach them about Jesus. Jesus loves you. They come to Christ, okay? Then what? Do we stop from there? That would be like taking an army recruit, handing him a rifle. He's never fired it, and you say, you're now a soldier, go into combat. He doesn't know how to operate it. He doesn't know how to take it apart, clean it. He doesn't really know the characteristics of the rifle, how it fires, anything. He's going to get slaughtered. So children need care and instruction on the basics of life in order to function and survive. It's the same with spiritual growth. Turn over to the second side here. God will use mature believers to teach and train younger Christians how to walk with Him. Now, as a homeschooling parent, one of the verses I am intimately familiar with is Proverbs 22:6. I'm not even going to turn there. Train up a child in the way that he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. That's an emphatic statement. There is no question mark at the end. It's a period. Train up a child in the way that he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. And there's a lot of people that struggle with that, and they say, well, it wasn't true in our case. Well, the Word of God is either true or it's not. Either it is true that if you train up your child in the way that he should go, okay, and if you say you did that and he still departed and he went and he's living his own life and he rejected God, where must the responsibility lie? The parent. If we say that the Bible is not true, well, we can just take this and just throw this away now. Because if one thing in the Bible is suspect, probably two. If there's two, why not three, four, five? It's a very slippery slope. And when we start on that road, where it ends is we lose faith in God. So discipleship, what does that mean? Well, it means this. We have new believers that come into a church. We gather around them. We love on them. But that's not enough. You see, if I just loved on my children and I didn't train them, am I helping them? This is why the Bible says, train up a child in the way that he should go. Train him up. Flip over to 2 Timothy chapter 2 and verse 15. Second Timothy chapter 2 and verse 15. It says, study to show yourself approved unto God, a workman that needs not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Study. Part of growing spiritually is that we say, this is the Bible. I believe that this is the Bible. This contains the words of God. As such, I can read the words of God. I can learn about them. This is why God provided this for us. That's what he states in there, that these things are written here as an example for us. I can tell my children many, many times something, but I have found that when I write it down and I post something on the wall and I remind them and I say, look at that thing that's written over there. One of the things that we struggle with is we want our children in the process of doing school to say things out loud. It's not enough just to be thinking it in your mind, but to speak it aloud. Part of this is biblical because it says, for with the mouth confession is made unto salvation, right? That's biblical. And you can pray the sinner's prayer, so to speak, in your head, but there's something that happens when we speak words out loud. And so part of the thing is we say is when you're working on your mathematics, say the problem out loud. When you're working on a spelling word, say it out loud. And you would think that I'm asking them to rip out their own teeth. You know, it's the most difficult thing in the world. And I got tired of reminding them. So I wrote it all on a piece of paper. Go read that piece of paper. My son Isaac has probably read that paper, I kid you not, a couple hundred times. He has the paper memorized, I promise you. He knows what the paper says word for word. But it is a matter of actually doing it, is it not? Theory to reality. Flip over one chapter to chapter 3 there. In verse 16 it says, all scripture is given by inspiration of God, and it is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. Why? That the man of God may be perfect or complete, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. That's what the Bible is there. It's the guidebook. It's an instruction manual. And we would be amiss to sit and ignore it and say, oh, I remember many years ago when I was a teenager in high school doing mission trips to Mexico. And we'd go down for 1 week to Mexico and we'd have to write out our testimonies. And, you know, I'm not the person back then that I am today. I'm way more knowledgeable about the Bible. But I remember thinking, I wonder if there's, you know, a verse that talks about God's love. If only I could come up with a verse that talks about God's love. You know, someone said to me, what about John 3:16? Ah, that's too simple. Are you kidding me? It talks about God's love. Sometimes we take something that's simple and we say, oh, it's such a common something. I want something else. That may be. But what's common is also good. And when we put that into practice and we share those words with people, that God so loved the world, we're now speaking the word of God. I was talking to you about the soldiers, and I was saying that when they go into combat, it's kind of like a deadly game. It's not really a game, but it's very much deadly. It's to see which side can wipe out the other side. And that is the conflict that we have here. And in 1 Peter, flip over there, chapter 5, he brings this out. Because while the devil and his fallen angels, demons, and evil spirits, while they might play with us a little bit, like a cat does with the mouse, you know what the end game is with the cat. He will play with the mouse, but in the end, he will kill it. Sometimes the devil plays with us. Sometimes he's just out to wipe us out from the very beginning. That's his prerogative. But this is what Peter brings out here in 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse 8. Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary the devil, as a roaring lion, walks about seeking whom he may devour. He's not looking to do us good. He's looking to do us evil. There's the Christian life is not just a life of physicality. I'm here standing in front of you physical. But there's going to come a time when all of us dies and our soul and our spirit step out. Our body is laying on the ground. There is a spiritual aspect to this life as well. That's what the Christian walk is about. That is when you look at Moses, when you look at Joshua, when you look at Samuel, and when you look at the Apostle Paul, there was a spiritual aspect that they all had with God. It wasn't just them trying to live their life here on the earth. Yes, they were concerned with that, but there was the spiritual aspect of that, and it's that merger. I want to wrap this up here in Galatians chapter 6. And I wrote this on the outline. A farmer's crop is proportionate to the amount of seed sown. However much seed a farmer puts down, he can expect to yield something in that neighborhood. If he puts down one seed into a field, he cannot expect a whole field harvest. The Christian life is the same way. Whatever we put into it, however much effort we put into it, that's what we're going to get back. And this is what Paul says in Galatians 6, verse 7. Be not deceived. God is not mocked. Whatsoever a man sows, that shall he also reap. Whatsoever a man sows. Not, you know, someone's going to throw in something extra. Whatever it is that you sow, that's what you're going to reap. And that simply means that our actions echo into eternity. The choices and decisions that we make, the words that we speak to each other, we speak hateful words, those echo into eternity. We speak words of love, those echo into eternity. All of our actions here on this earth are all leading toward eternity. Earth is just temporary. You might think, 120 years, that's a long time that you could be alive here on this earth. Not really. Not when you consider that when you've lived 1 trillion years in heaven, that's just the beginning. 5 trillion, 10 trillion. Why don't you add, 100 zeros behind that, and you're just getting started. And it just makes our time here on earth seem so short. And yet that's not reality, is it? It seems like a long time. So God will reward the effort that we put in our walk toward him. I wrote this here on the outline. Walking with God is not a sprint. Many times in our lives, we'll start a race and we'll just boom, real fast, right? That's a sprint. But if you're running a mile-long race, or you're running a 15-mile race, unless you're running on some kind of drugs or something, you're not going to be able to run at an all-out sprint. It is therefore important to pace yourself. Set a pace, maintain that, but run this Christian life with endurance. There's a lot of Christians that started out and then just died off. We want to be able to finish strong. That's the goal. Now, if you're listening to me and you've said to yourself, I'm not a Christian, well, that can be remedied right now. There is nothing that is stopping you from joining the kingdom of God and becoming a follower of Jesus. It just takes faith, saying, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, that he died for my sins, that he rose on the third day, and that through his death and resurrection, I can have eternal life. Continue listening, and we were going to put something on that's going to share this in more in depth. But do not put off. If you have never made a decision, there are only two places that you can go once you leave this earth, heaven or hell. That's it. Earth is not forever. It's just a temporary spot. So if you've never made a decision for Jesus, I would urge you to do so today. Father God, we thank you for today. And Father, as we read your Bible, we understand that you love us, that you desire a relationship with us. Help us, Father God, to walk in a manner that is worthy of you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hello there, friend. You might have some questions about Christianity. There are many so-called Christian churches out there. So what makes a person a Christian? How do you get right with God? And how do you know when you'll die that you'll go to heaven? How exactly does a person get to heaven? Does God have a standard? And if so, what is it? What I'm about to tell you will be the most important information you will ever hear on this earth. And your decision will determine how you spend eternity. As you continue listening, I will explain. The bad news is this. When we are born into this world, we are automatically born with sin. Now you might think of yourself as a good person. After all, you're nice to other people, you give money to charity, and you try to live a good life. However, everyone has sinned and fallen short of God's standard. So it doesn't matter how moral, religious, or philosophical you are, you've broken God's commandments, and that has separated you from God. The Bible says in Romans 3:23, "For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God." Now you might say, "Well, I'm a good person, doesn't that count for something?" Okay, let's take a little test. I'm going to ask you 3 questions. 1. Have you ever told a lie? 2. Have you ever stolen anything? even something insignificant like a paperclip at work. 3. Have you ever lusted after someone of the opposite sex? Okay, how did you do? Most likely you answered yes to all 3 questions, which means you just failed the test. You see, these 3 questions are but 3 of God's 10 commandments. Failing just one commandment disqualifies you from getting into heaven and has condemned you to hell. This is why the Bible says in Romans 6:23, "For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord." You see, God knows that we are all guilty of breaking His commandments. That's why He said we've all sinned and fallen short of His standard. But you don't have to be depressed about this. I do have some good news to share with you. In Romans 5:7 through 8, it says, "For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare to die. But God commends His love toward us in that, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us." You see, God loves you so much that He gave His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, to pay for the sin in your life. Jesus was more than just a good man. He was God becoming man and walking among us. That is why Jesus died on the cross. He took your place and paid for your sins with His shed blood so that you can have everlasting life. God loves you so much that He sent His own Son to pay a debt He did not owe, because you owe a debt you could not pay. Jesus bridged the gap created by sin between you and God. The Bible says in John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life." You see, there are 3 places we can exist in this universe: earth, heaven, and hell. So when we die here on earth, we don't just cease to exist. We will step out of our physical bodies and go to one of 2 places, heaven or hell. God did not send His Son to condemn you, but that through Jesus you might be saved and have eternal life in heaven. God's free gift to you is eternal life through His Son, Jesus Christ. That is why Jesus said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by Me." You see, God offers His love to you through Jesus, even though you are a sinner. This unmerited grace is not something you can buy or earn, but a gift from God. As you're listening right now and realize you're a sinner, know that God loves you and wants to save you. All you need to do is repent of your sins and ask God to forgive you. The word repent means to change your direction. You've been running away from God. Now it's time to start running toward Him. The Bible says in Psalms 103:12, "As far as the east is from the west, so far has He removed our transgressions from us." That means if you call out to God and confess your sins, He will forgive you. What Jesus has done in the past for others, He will do for you. If you call out to Him, He will answer you. He won't look down upon you because of your past, and there isn't a sin so great that it can't be forgiven. All He wants for you is to come to Him. He will help anybody who calls out to Him. If you have sin in your life, God still loves you. If you ask God to save you, He will do so. It is important to remember that talking to God can be done anywhere and anytime. You don't have to be in church to talk to God. He will meet you wherever you are. As you're listening to me right now, if you feel a conviction of sin in your life, that is God's Holy Spirit moving upon you. Friend, you need to repent of your sins right now and call out to Jesus. You might not get another chance. The Bible says today is the day of salvation. Friend, you need to make a decision today, one that will affect you for eternity. You have a choice. The road to hell is paved with good intentions, so act today. I would like to lead you in a prayer right now where you can ask Jesus Christ to come into your life and be your personal Lord and Savior. Now you might ask, what you just said, exactly what does that mean? Well, if you want to start anew and have your sins forgiven, Jesus is the way. There is no other way to God than through Jesus. I'm not talking about being religious. I'm talking about having a personal relationship with the God of creation who loves you so much and is just waiting for you to reach out to Him. That is what I mean by asking Jesus to come into your life and save you. Won't you pray with me right now? God, I confess that I am a sinner and that I need to be saved from my sins. Jesus, I ask that you would forgive me of my sins. I turn from them now, and I put my faith in you. Come into my life and be my Lord and Savior. I believe that you paid for my sins on the cross through your shed blood, and that you died for me and rose from the grave. Save me, Jesus. I know I can't save myself. Thank you for saving me and giving me eternal life and a place in heaven with you. Help me to be obedient and to walk with you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you just prayed with me and asked Jesus to save you, you are now a Christian. You have become born again and are a new creation in God's eyes. The Bible says in Romans 10:13, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." You see, you're not saved because you might feel saved, but because you have called upon God and He has saved you. Now, as a way to grow closer to Him, the Bible tells you to follow up on your commitment. Spend time with God each day. It doesn't have to be a long period of time. Just develop a daily habit of talking with Him and reading the Bible. Ask God to increase your faith and understanding of the Bible. Also, find a local church where you can worship God and seek fellowship with other Christians to answer your questions and support you. Be sure they use a King James Bible if you live in an English-speaking country, and that the pastor teaches out of the Bible. Plus, don't forget to share your new faith in Jesus with somebody else. After all, if I didn't make this recording to share with you, how would you have heard the good news? Finally, please contact us and tell us about your decision. We will send you some written material that will help you in your new walk with Jesus. This is Charles Thorell with European American Evangelistic Crusades. May you grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To Him be glory both now and forever.
You've been listening to the weekly webcast. This message was entitled Theory to Reality. All soldiers go through basic training, which challenges their physical fitness, provides weapon proficiency, and gives them a theoretical knowledge of warfare. They must put their training to use and pull together as a team in order to secure victory against an opponent that is actively resisting them. Christians have an enemy in Satan, and he isn't content just to kill us. He wants to wipe out humanity because we are made in the image of God. Moses went from being an exalted prince of Egypt to a lowly shepherd. God activated him at the burning bush, and he was able to put into practice the many things that he had learned in his first 80 years on earth. Joshua was an understudy of Moses, but eventually he had to stand on his own and know whether God was truly with him. The prophet Samuel was younger than most when he moved from theory to reality. The Apostle Paul had a life-changing experience where everything he knew to be true was turned upside down, and a hated Christian showed up to deliver healing and confirm the message that he had already heard from the Lord. The Bible says that whatsoever a man sows, that shall he also reap. This means that God will reward the effort that we put toward our walk with Him. This message is available on CD and DVD. When ordering, ask for sermon number 1645. There are several ways to contact our ministry. You can visit our website at eaec.org. There you can read insightful articles, watch or listen to a sermon broadcast, and explore the online store. The web address, once again, is eaec.org. If you prefer to write, address your envelope to European American Evangelistic Crusades, Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. That's Post Office Box 166, Sheridan, California, 95681. If you prefer to call us, the number is 916-944-3724. That's 916-944-3724. Resurrection Life of Jesus Church is sponsored by European American Evangelistic Crusades, and this has been a production of EAEC. Thanks for joining us today, and until next time, may God richly bless you as you read your Bible and walk with Him.